So it'd probably be helpful to kind of introduce my guests too, so you guys can all know who we're talking to today. So we have with us today, Daniel, Mercedes, and JT, and they are joining us from all different parts of the world. So Daniel is joining us from Brazil. Mercedes is joining us from Boston here, to anyone that is around the area. And JT is joining us from Switzerland, correct?
Yep.
So it's a little bit later over there. As you can see, it's kind of nighttime in the background, where if anyone in the States is joining us, it is still kind of sunny out. Without further ado, I'm going to hand it off to, I think Mercedes is going first, and then we'll just keep on going with this stuff. So they're going to be telling you all about their careers, what STEM is like in different parts of the world, kind of their experiences and all that stuff, so everyone can get a good idea of what's going on around the world. So give me 1 second to pull this up. All right. Mercedes, is your slide showing? I can't see on the other screen.
It's perfect. It's showing. Thank you. Perfect. So thank you, Connor, for the opportunity to be here. First, I'm going to start talking a little bit about myself, something personal, not my resume, but you need to know when you meet me. First, I'm from Barcelona, Spain, and I am in love with that city. I grew up seeing the beautiful architecture and opening my eyes and being always like, oh, I am the typical person that is still to this day. Every time I see something beautiful, man-made or nature, I take photos. I am a very crazy skier. I love speed. I have been in a ski team, and to this day, I still think I am 15. And one day I'm going to kill myself because I love to race, slalom, giant slalom, super G, everything. And I also jump. So I think I have to be careful. Now I have had surgeries in my two knees, thanks to that risk taking. But still loving to ski. The third thing I wanted to share with you is when I decided to be a scientist and my aha moment, because I liked a lot of things, or I didn't know what to choose. It's very difficult to choose. And when I was in seventh grade, I had this wonderful chemistry teacher. Her name was Mrs. Ustaris. And she was trying to teach us the periodic table of the elements. And that lead, you know, you need to memorize a lot of elements and things that are not so exciting sometimes. But she made that comment, a very clear comment. She said to us, this is just the tip of the iceberg. This is just elements that we know. And what you read in the textbook is only a small portion of the unknown. There is so many more things that we don't know. And that day, I knew I wanted to be a scientist and I wanted to discover things. And I wanted to pursue chemistry to discover the new element in the periodic table. The fourth and last thing of my personal life is that I come from a big Spanish family. This is the photo on the right that you can see. I am the oldest of five siblings. And since with this passion of being a discoverer, a scientist, we spend a lot of time every weekend in my grandmother's house that had a backyard. So I run a very unorthodox clinical trial. Mainly, I fed my siblings all the leaves, the plants, the fruits, everything possible that could be mashed and created a mixture. I fed it to them. So the good news is that there is no toxic materials in my grandmother's backyard, so nobody died. But my mom always wondered why everybody had some side effects like, you know, diarrhea and things like that, except from me. So yeah, that was my first experiments with human subjects. And again, don't do it. Don't repeat it at home. Okay, Connor, you can pass the slide. So that was about my personal life and my beginnings. What I do is, I always say I do tissue engineering. Tissue engineering in Spanish is ingeniería de tejidos, in Portuguese, ingeniería de tejidos. And so when I say that, people think I make tissue for a living, and that's tissue, you know, or clothes. In Spanish, tejido is clothes. And this is a great job to pursue, but this is not exactly what I do. When I mean tissue engineering is substitutes of organs and tissues. So when you have a heart attack because the arteries that feed your heart are blocked, we have a spare artery, for example. So what I use in the lab regularly, beautiful, I mentioned architecture and beauty. In beauty, on the left you see I use human cells from different sources and different parts of the body. that I use as my one of my key ingredients, if you want to call them. I use scaffolding material, like the one you would have in a building, you know, when you restore a facade of a building, so that the cells can attach to that scaffold that is a material, a nature-inspired material, a material I have synthesized in the lab. I want to say I cook, I love cooking, because I cook materials that I cannot eat. That scaffold material is used by the cells to attach and grow and produce their own matrix, their own tissue. But there is also a third ingredient, which is very important to me, and that I bring back to the skin, the aerodynamics, the shear. This is the mechanical environment and where cells grow. It's not the same as me that feels the compression constant, you know, your knee cells, that another, you know, like an artery in your heart that feels the shear stress, the frictional force of the blood flowing inside your artery. So that mechanical environment is crucial. So this is what the three ingredients in my lab, in my everyday lab, to do substitutes for different organs, for the heart or the for example, this I'm going to show you because I am in the lab today. I'm going to show you something that looks like a bifurcation. It's a carotid bifurcation. It doesn't have cells. I would be using my gloves and it will not be here. This is just a plastic material. Normally we lay layer by layer different cells to make it into something that resembles an artery. The same would happen in the brain. We have capillaries in the brain and brain tissue. And why we do that? Because to replace when your organs are failing, but also to understand why they are failing. For example, when they are under attack, like a virus, why a virus would get into the brain of unborn babies, you know, like the Zika virus, and create a disease. It's difficult to have unborn babies, you know, to open their heads and say why a virus is permeating your brain. But if you have a model of a brain or what it is, the blood-brain barrier, you can study what goes across that barrier and what shouldn't go. And so that these mock organs and tissues are being used in my lab for understanding better when they start failing and to create solutions. For example, this is a joke. Eh? My student joke, this is a stent that would is a vascular device that it may be for a dinosaur maybe, okay? They joke. The real stents, just to give you an idea. I don't know if you can see it. See it? Can you see it? Yeah. It's much smaller. This is for a femoral artery in your body. So human size, elephant or dinosaur size, a joke from my students. So that's a prosthesis that you would insert an artery inside an artery that is clogged to reopen it. And this has been, you know, developed in the Edelman lab where I work. And this is what I wanted to share with you. I love science. I love engineering. I love collaboration with everybody from different disciplines, from different countries. I speak 5 languages and I use them in a daily basis. So it comes, I regret I don't speak Portuguese. I was telling Daniel. So this is me, and I'm welcoming any question that you guys have for me.
Awesome. Thank you, Mercedes. And yeah, guys, feel free to post questions in the chat at any time. And we're going to circle back to those kind of as we finish up with all three speakers. So if you have anything that pops into mind now, feel free to post it there. And now I'm going to pass it off to JT. So JT, if you want to share your screen or your slides, it is the floor is yours.
Yep, great. Thank you very much. Let me just figure this out first.
Of course.
Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. There you go. So yeah, good evening, everyone. Good afternoon to most everyone. And maybe there are some people also in Asia. I don't know why you're here because it's very early in the morning there. But yeah, so thank you for having me here. I'm JT. My name, as I told Mercedes earlier before everyone joined, is too long to remember. That's why I just call myself with 2 letters. I'm currently the Senior Director, Global Medical Lead for Neuromuscular Diseases in Biogen, with a specific region that I'm taking care of, which is the Intercontinental Region. In Biogen, the BIR is really just a fancy way of saying anything and everything outside of the US and Europe and Canada. So that's what I'm taking care of. And currently in neuromuscular diseases, I'm specifically taking care of both spinal muscular atrophy, as well as ALS. Okay, so I'll just remove this one. Okay, there we go. Oops. There you go. So yeah, so I was asked to like give my story in like 5 minutes, but I saw that I have a 10 minutes, so maybe I'll slow down a bit. I talk very, very fast. But yeah, so basically, if you see on this world map, currently I am responsible for everything that is here, that's dark gray. And in these countries, I have lived in 5 places, which I'll go through. I will not probably be diving deep into what I do on a daily basis. You can ask me later if you are interested in that, but I want to share with you how I got to where I am from the time I was born. So I was born in 1978 in Manila, which is the capital of the Philippines, Spanish colony. And that's why we were laughing earlier that the 3 speakers today have Spanish blood in us, so which is good. The diversity is there, but we're just spread out across the globe. I've always wanted, ever since I was a kid, to become a doctor, and that's the reason why I went into medicine and graduated back in 2002. A year after that, I moved somewhere else. I'll tell you more about that. But right now, in the Philippines, only my son and his mom are staying there in Manila. I haven't seen them since early last year because of COVID, but I do hope to get them here to visit, or me to visit the Philippines sometime soon. The rest of my family is in the US, in Western, in Virginia, in Alexandria, and they have been there since I graduated from med school. In 2003, I moved to Singapore and started my practice in surgery. For a while, for about 4 years. And at that time, I wasn't sure whether I will be remaining in Singapore in practice because I was a foreigner, a foreign student, a foreign doctor. And at that time, of course, I was still young. I got to meet a lot of people. And one of them was my future boss, who was in Sanofi, a French company, drug company. And he was in clinical research. So he asked me to join him to do clinical studies in Southeast Asia. So I was the medical advisor and clinical safety officer for all the clinical trials that we have been doing in Sanofi at that time. So I was taking care of diabetes, oncology, multiple sclerosis. And that's the reason why in 2011, I was found by Biogen and I was asked to join the company. So that started in 2012. I was taking care of Asia Pacific, all the way from South Korea, India, Southeast Asia, and eventually China. And then around 2015, I was asked to take care of the medical team in Japan. So I moved to Tokyo in 2015. And I was there for 3 years. I created the medical excellence and operations team there. And at that time, we did not yet have any offices in Korea, in Taiwan, and in Hong Kong. And I was asked to whether I'd be interested to help out building that those teams, and I did. So it didn't make sense for me to stay longer in Tokyo because I was not taking care of Japan anymore. So I was moved to Hong Kong in 2019. Which was really great. And across all these years, from 2007 all the way to end of 2019, I've been traveling like crazy across because of all the responsibilities that I have to make sure that our teams are able to deliver the benefits to our patients in all of our therapeutic areas. So when COVID-19 happened last year, until now, it's the first time in 13, 14 years that I was in one place for longer than a month, which initially was scary for me, but actually it was great because I was able to know the city. I was able to know Hong Kong. And it was one of the best times, the best summers in my life. So you see here my friends and my partner. We've been going on junk trips, boat trips, parties over there. Unfortunately or fortunately, I was asked last year to take care not of just Asia Pacific, but also Latin America, Middle East, Africa, Russia, and Turkey, on top of Japan and Asia Pacific. And in order for me to still maintain sort of good life, it will not make sense for me to stay in Hong Kong. It would be better for me to be here in Switzerland. So I moved here in October so that I'll be able to help out all of our colleagues in these different markets. And again, I think still my passion is still with the patients, with the doctors that we interact with across time, and as well as my friends and colleagues in Biogen. And across these 20 or so years, I think these are the three things that helped me drive and be where I am. Empathy is number one. I always think about what others feel and how I can make them feel good or feel better. I want to put myself in their situation, and of course, I don't want me to be in a bad situation. Same thing for others. Hunger is one of the things that I want to see in everyone that I work with and everyone that I hire. The probably one of the reasons that I am where I am now is I've always not been satisfied. I've always been hungry for more, such that I will be able to give more to others. And across all this, really, the highest driving force is about life. I always tell my team, we are working so that we can live. We don't live to work. So please, for everyone, you're just starting your lives as adults and as contributing people in society, please make sure that you always remember the most important thing is about yourself, your family, your friends, and you are working so that you can have a better life with everyone. And if you want to know more about me, I am on LinkedIn with my name, JT Tibung, as well as if you want to know anything personal in my life, I'm on Facebook as well as Instagram. I'm not that old yet, so but I am. Okay, with that, I end my introduction.
Thank you, JT. let me share my screen for Daniel, and then we will get this kicked off. All right, so now for our last speaker, we have Daniel. And when you see my screen, you can feel free to take it away and just tell me when to move slides, and the floor is yours.
Will do. Thank you, Connor. So good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on where you are. So thank you for having me here today. It's a pleasure. So let me start saying that I always loved science, right? And the reason because of that is because I really believe that science can have the power to change the world and transform people's lives. Right. Differently from my colleagues here in the panel, I did not make my career in science, right? So I'm a lawyer by education, right? So although until the very last year of my high school, I was thinking be a doctor as JT, but then I decided to go to the law school. But the destiny played tricks on us, right? So, and I ended up working for the pharmaceutical industry, where I have been working over almost the last 20 years now. So let me correct myself here and rephrase what I just said. I did almost my entire career in dealing with science and innovation as well. So as you guys can see here, I'm very passionate for innovation and people development, and I have worked for several different pharmaceutical companies during these 20 years. But I do have the pleasure for working for Biogen over the last 8 years now. And when I say pleasure, I really meant pleasure, because Biogen for me is the best company that I have ever worked for. And I'm gonna give you the reasons for that. So Connor, if you can go to the next slide.
Yep.
So why Biogen, right? So why I keep saying to the people, how work for Biogen looks like. And the very good reasons that I'm gonna provide to you here, and I have included here in the slides, I'm gonna walk you through for each one of them. First thing is the science, right? So which other company has the privilege to have one winner of Nobel Prize as its founder? So here at Biogen, we don't have only one, we have two Nobel Prize winners as our founders, right? So we do have the science and innovation in our DNA, and we do follow the best science in almost everything that we do here in the company. Right? The follow-on is the people, right? So here at Biogen, we do not only have the many of the most brilliant professionals around the world working for this company, but we have also great human beings. People are supportive, collaborative, always available to help each other, right? So we work here with a good level of autonomy, good, everything that we do has a great level of exposure, and people are recognized for their efforts. So the next one for me is one of the most important ones, right? Is because this is the meaning that we do have here in the company as the purpose, right? For with what we do here, which is the patient and the caregivers, right? So this is very meaningful for us here and gives us the sense of purpose. So Biogen really puts the patient at the center of everything that we do here, right? And this is impressive. How impactful is what we do here in the company for them. So we do work with devastating disease, right? So when we see the impact that we do in the patient's lives and their family's lives, it's unbelievable. Right, so that's the reason why I wake up every day here to work. But it's not only that, we also have our pipeline where we have almost 30 molecules under development by now, right? Which makes us very proud of, and JT can talk more about that later on. And what's the reason to be proud of? Because we can keep providing hope for the patients out there, the world, but also to address medical needs that we have. And last but not least, right, Biogen has very high integrity and compliance standards, which provides us a good level of comfort and makes our lives easier in our role as employers, and in my case in particular as a legal officer. And so if we can move to the next slide. So the people keep asking me, okay, so you're passionate for innovation. So how to innovate working in compliance in a legal arena? So I brought here for you guys some of the examples of things that we have been doing in my team here, right? To make sure that we are being creative in innovating in the legal and compliance arena. So the first one here is a compliance manual, the format of comics that we have created to make the communication easier with our employees, right? It calls the attention. It's very colorful here, as you can see, in a very easy language. So people can consult that, the people they can make questions, they can find answers for their questions and doubts. And people really love this new format of that. We have also developed some augmented reality here. You can see here the avatar with one of our compliance officers in the company. So with that, you can have one of us in your pockets, in your mobile phone. You can take us everywhere, wherever you are. We can access that with a QR code and have access to our policies, our procedures, and keep asking to these avatars one of your questions. We have also created some games, compliance games, right? What we have figured out which is that gamification really keeps people motivated, engaged in our trainings in a different innovative way to train people, right? People enjoy to play, people enjoy to compete to each other. And whenever we have games, people keep engaged in their path. And lastly, here we also have created some compliance podcasts that you can hear everywhere, anywhere, at any time, right? Consult if you have any doubts, right? And of course, this is another innovative way. So people asking me, okay, so how we can be innovative in compliance and legal arena in the pharmaceutical industry. And I usually say that if you really want, there will always be a way out there for you. And I think that's it from my end. Thank you.
Awesome. So thank you three for sharing your all your stories and kind of how, what you kind of took all your words coming, your journeys to get to where you are today. So now we're going to move into the question and answer panel. I need more coffee. So if anyone has questions, feel free to post that in the chat and we can definitely get those answers for you. And I do have some questions to kind of get us kickstarted. So you guys all kind of talked at the beginning, there weren't very many students here at the beginning, about the different languages that you guys speak. Can you guys each tell us how many languages you speak and what they are? Just to kind of like, I mean, I thought it was pretty cool. Someone that speaks one language.
I speak Spanish, English, Catalan, German, and French.
I speak my language, Tagalog. I speak English. I can speak a few words in Malay, in Tamil, and in Mandarin. A bit of Hokkien. I can read Korean. I have started learning Japanese when I was in Japan, but only to order beer and tell the taxi driver how to get me home. I know also how to read Russian, but I don't understand it. And I'm now starting to learn German. I don't know how many that was.
So I do speak Portuguese, English, and Spanish. Of course, I can understand a bit of French and Italian as well. And to Amanda's question here, which I think it's important, how we use those languages in our daily basis. It's very important, right? So because we can connect with more people around the world, and even with just quite a few words in some language, this can open a lot of doors to us. Just if you just know to say
hello,
thank you, hello, excuse me, right? This kind of magic words, this really open doors to start engaging in new conversations with different people.
I have a lot of collaborators in all over the world. MIT is a very international place. And when we come here, we speak English, but very quickly they bring their network and you end up, talking to schools and hospitals in Sao Paulo, in Barcelona. The other day I had a meeting with a senator in Congo. So I had to rescue my French. So very quickly you find yourself more comfortable and I think it helps to speak other languages when you are trying to collaborate.
And that's what really makes it very exciting. I mean, when I first went into the industry and was starting to take care of the region, that was the exciting part, because it's like you try to like understand other people, not just about them understanding you, right? And that's where those connections come in. And trust me, in life, that is the most important, connecting with people.
Agreed.
And someone asked a follow-up question. How many years did it take you guys to learn each of those languages? Like, was there like a general time for one? Was one harder than the other? Like,
I think it gets easier as you go. So I feel that I was learning English in school forever, since fifth grade. And then suddenly French took me less, and then German took me less also because I had the opportunity to go. And for example, in the case of German, I did my PhD in Germany. So I delve into the culture. That was part of the decision. I decided to go to Germany, not only to do my PhD in chemistry, but also to learn the language, take the double advantage. So so that was easier as it go. No, as it went. For me, it was easier. I don't know.
For me, I don't know whether it is... It becomes easier. I think when you have a motivation, for example, like you said earlier, if you have a boyfriend who speaks the language, then yes, it will be a lot easier. Or if you use it for work. But for me, like, for example, now, because even though I'm in Switzerland, I don't take care of Germany. and I have to learn German, but I don't use it. So it's very difficult for me. And same thing when I was in Japan. I did not have to speak Japanese. But when, for example, I really want to learn something because I want to use it on a daily basis, then yeah, that's the best. Right, English for Filipinos, if people don't know, in the Philippines, we speak both English and Filipino Tagalog at the same time. Well, we have a lot of Spanish words, so that's why for me, it's easy to speak with Mercedes and Daniel because the words are quite similar.
And I agree with that. Any new language that you learn, you develop a new skill, right? So you have your ears trained to listen more, to understand more. Even though you don't speak one language, it's easier for you to understand what they're saying. But it takes time. It's hard to say an average of that, but it takes time, but you end up doing that.
Awesome. I do have another question too. So since no one here was born in the States, has being someone that is not American, has that made that, you know, more difficult or more easy to find, you know, like you're placing your STEM career? Like, can you speak to that a little bit?
I always start, so I'm going to let you guys start. Daniel is always the last.
Daniel, go for it.
DJ, follow you.
Okay. So thank you. So for me, I think it really did not matter. I don't know whether it's because I was in Asia, where, well, most everyone is Asian, right? But even within Biogen, which is what I love about being in Biogen, is that it really didn't matter whether I'm American, non-American, white, not white, Asian, gay, not gay, straight, it doesn't matter. What really matters is what you deliver for the team, what do you deliver to the doctors, to the patients, etc. It doesn't matter who you are, right? And that's what I am very, very proud of here in Biogen. And it doesn't come naturally, right? It's for a company to be in that situation. It is a conscious effort. And I think everyone has a part to play in that.
I agree with that, GT. And this is the beauty of the diversity. Right. So, and diversity goes for different ways, right? Different meanings, not only gender, as JT just mentioned, but in my team, for example, I have different genders, but I do have different backgrounds as well, right? Which also helps us out to have a better team, right? A different way to work, different deep thinking process, right? Different experience and different expertise keep adding. But I agree with you, JT. I mean, for Biogen, it doesn't matter where you are, where you came from, but actually what you do, right, and how you do that.
In my experience, coming to the US was, I have always been a minority, okay? When you study chemical engineering, material science and engineering, we were very few. And in Germany, I was the only female in my whole dorm, the only international. So I was the queen, basically. They treat me very well, but I never noticed anything different or special, but I was definitely different, okay? To this day, I think Germany, well, now it's changing because Germany was my adoptive land and now it's America, so I have many adoptive lands. But the one thing I would say is that both growing up in Barcelona and in Germany, it was very homogeneous. Everybody was Caucasian that I grew up and went to college to. And in my case, a lot of men, very good looking guys, believe me, but but a lot. When I came to MIT and to Boston, but specifically to MIT, the internationals, the diversity, but also, but moreover, the meritocratic, you know, like nobody knew me here. Nobody. I just knocked on the door of a professor. I had a list of 5 professors. And instead of sending an email and requesting an interview, I just planted myself in Boston with the last money I had from my fellowship when I finished my PhD in Germany. And I knocked down at their doors. And out of the 5, 4 were there and they opened. And I just said, hello, my name is Mercedes. I am just finishing my PhD in Germany and I want to work with you. And they say, oh, please sit down. So out of that, I had four job offers. 20 years later, one of them, which is still my current boss, confessed that he was very nervous, thinking, oh my goodness, I forgot this woman, this young student comes all the way from Europe to see me, and it was not in my calendar. So I had to confess that it was not his mistake. It was never in his calendar to start with. So for me, coming to MIT was amazing, seeing how they value merit, not who your parents are or your friends or what, you know, just pure meritocratic. That was very different. My lab is, there are as many women as men. I have two girls now, and we all have had our babies while working full time, taking, you know, the 2 months maternity leave or whatever you want to take, but working full time. And I have I have been privileged and lucky to be in Professor Edelman's lab. I think it's the more productive lab in all the senses, scientific and academically, and creating families. It was very opening and very, for me, eye-opening. Everybody is so diverse. Always there is something interesting. You may like it more or less, but it's interesting, it's different, it's exciting. That's what diversity brings at work and in life. And definitely MIT, it has very interesting people from all over the world. So it's always something you find yourself, I don't know, taking a drum class, you know, I did it, or a tango class, or you know, meeting very different people, which I didn't have that growing up in Barcelona. Everybody talk about the same. Everybody was a Barcelona soccer fan. If you were from the Espanol, you were in trouble. And in Germany, a little bit of the same. I don't know if I explain myself, but here is more diverse. It was some years ago, you know? So to be fair, I have not been back there to live. And maybe now it's as diverse as here and as rich as here. But MIT is very different than Cambridge in that sense. I feel very fortunate for that.
Awesome, thank you guys. All right, now there's another question. And Daniel, I think we should start with you for this one. Seeing as how you like science and kind of transitioned out of it, but still work with STEM every day. So for all of you guys, and it looks like JT typed his answer, but JT, you can feel free to speak on this one too. How do science and STEM impact your daily life outside of work, if it has at all?
Totally, and this is a good one, Connor, actually, because when people look at me now, they quite forget that I'm a lawyer and start talking about science in front of my friends, right? So that you that work for a pharmaceutical industry, tell me about this new product, new science, neuro developments, right? So they do not talk to me about my education, right? My lawyer role. But instead, what are the news in the pharmaceutical industry? So this is very, very funny. I do have a brother which did not make his career in science as well, but end up working for medical device. So it's funny because the two of us end up working with science, and we sometimes laugh about it, right? Because people keep talking to us about other things than our own education. So this is how, I mean, I see this impacting my personal life outside of the work, but not only that, right? So we really see the world from different angles, from different lens, whenever we have different perspectives working for science, right? Just open up your eyes for different things that if you're not working for with science, you will never know.
Mercedes, go. How does science help you outside of work?
Science is part of my DNA, so it's always there. It's very difficult. Actually, for me, it's a challenge because sometimes I don't want to be talking about science. I just want to do things that are regular and have a, you know, but it's so much in me that even my daughters at home said, "Mommy, over dinner?" No. You know, so, but they asked me, so I have to answer. So it is part of my life entirely. Sometimes now during the times we are living, it goes even beyond my expertise. I have to stop people because they ask me about policy, about laws. So Daniel, I need you. And I'm like, I'm not qualified. You know, if you are asking me, Mercedes Balcells, my personal opinion, I can give you, but me, they, it is difficult to uncouple my professional life from myself outside. So I have to be careful because people are sending me texts and asking me if they should be vaccinated. And I'm like, I think so, but this is me, my personal me, you know, because I truly believe, and I know some of the bright scientists that have developed some of the vaccines, the Moderna vaccines. So it's very difficult to uncouple. So I find myself trying to sometimes even, you know, if it's not friends and family, which I cannot hide, when I go out trying to make believe I'm not a scientist. A small anecdote, when I was dating, you know, they ask you, what do you do for work? And you are in different option. Some people just vanish. You don't want to be with a brain scientist. So it didn't help me much.
What about you, JP?
No, I've answered it in the chat, I think I share Mercedes on top of what I said in the chat. But Mercedes, I share your what you said regarding you not being able to decouple that science person from who Mercedes is outside. Me being a doctor, even though I haven't been in practice already for 13 years, 14 years. My family, my friends, just knowing that I'm a doctor, always ask anything and everything. I have a headache, what do I do? Even if they're not with me here. It's like, oh, you have to see a doctor to be able to see what's happening with you. I cannot diagnose and treat you over the internet, right? So yeah, that's a difficult thing. And of course, all the legal implications if something bad happens to them. I think being in science has given me really a lot of opportunities. This question that I saw just now, whether when I was younger, I knew that I was going to Biogen or to a big company, I can tell you, no. In the Philippines, I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with how we think in the Philippines. There were only two things for me, how my career would pan out. It's either I become a surgeon in the Philippines or a surgeon in the US. Neither is what I am now. Being in the industry or being in Sanofi in R&D and being in Biogen in medical has never been part of my plans. However, when I moved into the industry, when my my chairman in surgery asked me, JT, are you sure you want to do this? If you think that you've made the mistake, you're welcome to come back. This is now 14 years. I have never gone back into practice. I think that what I am doing right now is helping more people than I could if I were treating patients surgically one by one. So I think I'm happy with the decisions that I have made.
Awesome. It looks like there's a lot of questions pouring in, so this is awesome. So now for the panel, what made you guys decide that you wanted to study what you ended up studying? What was like that moment that said, this is what I want to do with my life and my career?
At least to me, this is a very difficult one, right? Because when the time for you to decide, you are very young, right? So sometimes you have 16 or 17 years old to decide what you're gonna do for your entire career and your entire life. It's a very big decision. It's a very big decision you need to take when you're so young, looking back in the days. So I think that, I mean, you should at least look for something that has some fit with your own values, right? If you believe that, if you believe in your own values, go for it. Go for it, and you're gonna end up deciding for the good, right? And the right fit will come with the time.
Yeah, I think they make it sound very critical. I remember being 17 and saying, "What I do? I like chemistry. I'm good at math. I like biology. I like medicine. I know how to write. I won a writing competition, so I like literature." So I was totally confused. And that day that I had to choose, I guess I woke up this morning with my chemistry leg. So I put chemistry, you know, next day, maybe I would have put biology. And I think it would have been just fine. I don't think it's so, It's important, Daniel. I don't disagree with you, but I think life gives you opportunities. It's not a dead end. I did my master's in chemistry, my bachelor's in chemistry, my master's in chemical engineering, my PhD in material science and engineering, and I am surrounded by doctors. I'm not a doctor, a practicing physician by no means, but I am all the time with cardiologists, neurologists, psychiatrists, so I cannot touch a patient, but I have been in the ER seeing how they cath people and not passed out, for the record. So it's good. So I think the way education goes, and not just education, life, it allows you changes. You know, you look for the changes or the opportunity presents and you're like, whoa, I'm gonna, and there is no mistake. So I think we have this expression, all the roads bring you to Rome, you know? So as long as you're happy, there are many roads to bring you there. And there is always ways where it forks and you can go right and left. And it's not the typical dramatic right to a cliff, left to heaven. No, okay? All brings you somewhere. And as long as you are motivated, happy, and you are, you know, and you put work, you know, and you like it, you're going to succeed. And if not, you change.
Yeah,
that's it. You pivot.
I totally agree. I think all of us here are examples that nothing that you have probably planned in your earlier years is what you become. I mean, that happens definitely. But I think a lot of people become disillusioned, become disheartened with what they have chosen, but they still stick to it. Some of them eventually become happy, or some of them are miserable their whole lives. What I think that everyone has to think about is be open to opportunities. I mean, for me, like I said earlier, I didn't plan to be where I am now, and here I am, and I'm happy with what I have achieved and what I am delivering or giving to other people, both in the industry, but also outside of it. My family, my friends are very proud of this. And that's what you have to be thinking about. The other thing that I heard, I think a few days ago from Elon Musk, which somehow I don't agree with, but somehow it's true, at least in for some people, is that college is really not necessary. It's not something probably we should be saying in this group, but I think it's something that we should hear. That there, for some people, that might be a path, because now in the day and age of the internet and the day and age of things that people can do even without studying, like a lot of people, that can happen. However, very few people really succeed in those pathways. What you are doing now, going into STEM, actually makes you or gives you a better platform for you to succeed later on in life. Whatever path it is in STEM, it really doesn't matter. It's really about what you are passionate about. See what you will make you happy and go for it. If at some point in your life, when you're 25, when you're 28, 30, you see that, oh, this is not making me happy, but you see something there that might, don't be afraid, because for all you know, it's gonna make you happy. And eventually, as you grow older, it doesn't make you happy, it's never too late. I see other people who are like in their 50s, 60s, change different into different jobs, and they're content, they're happy. So be open.
Great. Choose happiness, right? Is the word here. Choose to be happy. And there was a time when I was talking to a friend of mine who worked for another company for a couple of years, right? So when he left to do something completely different, people say, oh, you're very courageous, you're very brave. And he said, no, I would be brave if I stay where I was. Because now I choose to be happy and following my dreams. So if you follow your dreams, don't be afraid of the change, choose to be happy.
And at the beginning, we talk about languages, you know, it's like starting a new language. STEM is the same. At the beginning, the basic for mathematics, the basic for chemistry, you need to learn the periodic table. So it's hard. But once you get a little bit intermediate, it's like playing a piano, you know, first you have to do the scales. And then suddenly, wow, I can play piano and I enjoy and I, you know, and it flows. So I think you have to be patient. You have to stick there for, I would say, some years, you know, a couple of years at least, if not three. And then it gets past that you know, that energy of activation, where then it flows, you know. Most of the things that you do in a school are difficult, you know, and are very basic, but you need to, you know, it's like hard work. You are learning the tools and you need those tools. You need, like in a language, you need the vocab and you need the grammar, and then you can speak, you know. So it's difficult, but I think you have to hang on there, because then it's a lot of fun.
Another really cool question just came in, and this is one that definitely is thought of a lot, especially with, like, you know, high stress careers. You need to learn a lot of information to get through this. How has your career affected your mental health, and do you do anything to kind of keep that in check, to kind of make sure that you keep your mental health strong?
I can start. It's very stressful. I live out of science. That means the things that we. So I need to sell to people that what I'm doing in the lab is going to be a solution for a disease in the future. So imagine fast forward in the future. That means I have to write projects to fundraise and get my research supported. I need to write papers that are reviewed and need to be approved by peers that critically, you know, formulate constructive criticism. So it's very stressful. So how I deal with that, trying to have a balanced life. And balance means I am Mercedes the scientist, I'm Mercedes the friend, and I'm Mercedes the family member. And it's the, and Mercedes who sleeps, sorry, divided by four. So I sleep 7 hours every day. You know, I go like a light, it's mandatory. Earlier, I used to be a later person, but earlier. I have a fourth of the day for me, Mercedes, you know, that means I go out with friends, I go for a walk, and I bike, in the winter I ski. And then I have my family, and then I have my science. So it's actually very trying, you know, to distribute that so that I have the different outlets. But for me, the outlets are friends, family, and running, you know, sports, walking, and having fun going out with friends and family. I don't meditate. Okay. So that's not me. But I think I have heard people that helps. I don't do yoga. I used to, but not longer. But I go out and have fun with friends and family.
Yeah, great. It's not easy, right? It's not easy. I mean, there are a lot of pressure, whatever you do. Many people are looking for your support, looking for answers, right? And you need to be always there for them. So, but you need to find the right balance for that, right? The right balance of your life, personal and professional life as well. And we can do that in different ways. You can do that trying to find things that you like to do, right? Like such as sports, right? So workout, running, whatever you like to do. But you also need to find some pleasure in working, right? So particularly myself, I'm very grateful, I mean, with the deliverables. Whenever I can deliver something, right, to the people who are asking for support and they can see the results of that, very grateful. This is rewardable, right? I'm happy with the results whenever I deliver something that people are looking for. So those are the small pleasures that working for something that we really enjoy doing can give to you. So if you do not like what you do, it takes more difficult for you to keep doing that for a long period of time. But if you really enjoy, if you have fun, if you work hard, but you also play hard, you're gonna end up finding the right balance in your life.
I totally agree, and Daniel, I'm following that completely. The other thing that I think everyone will have to train on is really how to disconnect. In order to preserve your mental health, I think a lot of us in the industry or in the academe, even doctors who are in practice, a lot of times we bring work home. And even especially in this time with COVID, where we are working from home, initially, you would we would think that we will be less productive, we will have more time to ourselves, etc., for our family. But the thing is, a lot of people have already realized that no, that is not the case. And actually, a lot more people now are working more than we did before COVID times. So you have to be able to really think very, very clearly in your mind that when you are talking about work, work stays at work, whether virtually or physically. And when you're at home, when you're with family, stick with your family, stick with your friends. Don't think about work. That will be part of how you'll keep yourself mentally and physically healthy.
Awesome. All right, and now we have about 2 minutes left, so I'm gonna ask you guys kind of one final question. So kind of like a two-parter, really, if you can answer these on the quicker side. So one, what are you guys most proud of in your career? And two, what would be a quick piece of advice that you'd give all of these students that are, that are considering some kind of career in STEM or some kind of future in STEM? So what are you proud of? And then a quick piece of advice for the students. Or anyone else that's joining us, not just students.
What I'm more proud of in my career is actually of the young talent and the students I have had over the years that are better than me. You know, that's what makes me proud. Just last week, I got a student of mine who got a paper in science, and I'm like, whoa. And I said, congratulations. And she's like, this is thanks to you because you believe in me 12 years ago. I'm like, no, what? So thank you. No, this is hard work on your side. But yeah, my students speak for it themselves. So I'm most proud of all their achievements. You know, I celebrate every single of them. And my advice to the students who are, you know, the young students in STEM is that follow your passion and work hard, and you will achieve any dream that you have. Dreams come true. So be careful what you dream.
Go for it, Tracy.
Yeah, no, I wrote in the chat that, yeah, I'm happy that, again, when I was in practice, I was happy that I was able to save lives directly. But in the industry, in pharma, I think I'm very happy that those products that I've worked on, not that I was the only one working on it, there are hundreds of people that are working on these as well, but I've been part of how we have advanced science over the years that will that has started to help people out, patients with diabetes, patients with SMA, patients with multiple sclerosis. I'm very, very proud and happy about that. I think it's a very good thing that if not for companies like Biogen, like Sanofi, these would not have happened, right? The other thing that I wrote here is that I'm very, very happy that with what I have been doing, I'm now able to, I did not come from a rich family. I come from a lower middle class family in the Philippines, and I came from a barrio that is a place in the Philippines that you wouldn't think someone would be in Zurich when he's 43. And this is something that I think that I'm very thankful for, that this opportunity for me to be able to give back to the people that have made me who I am now. Not just my family, my parents, and my siblings, but also to the schools. I mean, when I was practicing, I have been able to help people become doctors themselves, right? And I think that's what I'm happy about, being able to receive all these things over the years and also to give back.
And same line for me as well. I mean, I'm very proud for the people that I had the opportunity to help develop across the years or over the years. And also, I mean, for me, it's whenever we have patients accessing our products, right, and changing their life with a very important impact, which makes their lives much better than what they would have without our treatments. This makes me very, very, very proud of. And in terms of the advice, I'm gonna say something that my grandpa used to say to me. I mean, there is always someone looking at what you're doing for the good and for the bad. So if you sleep at night, right, when you're in your bed at night, and you can state to yourself, I did my best today, then you are on the right path and you are on the right track. So keep doing that. Keep doing that.
Awesome. Thank you guys for all of your, I mean, amazing answers. The discussion was truly one of a kind. Hopefully all the students got a great joy out of this. So I give you a quick round of applause. Unfortunately, I don't know if the students can do the round of applause through the chat thing, but we do appreciate everyone being here. And for all the students that are checking in now, feel free to check out our next event in the third Wednesday of May. No, it is May. Third Wednesday of June. Sorry about that. I know. I told you that. I said it like three times. The words aren't working today. But once again, thank you guys so much for speaking to the students today. I really appreciate your time.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks, Mercedes and Daniel.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hello, thank you.
Perfect.
Thank you. Gracias, Mercedes.
A ti, gracias.